This is an execution plan. If you have never seen one of these, you're probably in the wrong session. Every operator in the execution plan has its own task. Some physical operators can only do one single task, while others support several variations called logical operations. The most versatile of all operators support no less than 11 to 13 logical operations. Some of them change behavior so much that many people think it's two different physical operators. Introducing Hash Match, the operator. In this session, you will learn about all its logical operations. We will dive deep into the internals of this operator, and we will explore its documented and undocumented features. This is going to be a wild ride. If you think it's too much for you to handle, leave now. We will not mock you. At least not when you can still hear it. For your safety, keep your hands, arms, and legs inside the conference room at all times, and please remain seated until the presenter has come to a full stop. Here's your host for today, Hugo Cornelis!
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I had that on recording in case you didn't. So here is why you should always make sure that I am not bored. This idea started when I was in the back of a car on my own, two people on the front chatting. The car was noisy, so I couldn't hear what they were saying. There was no Wi-Fi signal for my phone, and it was boring outside. The landscape was the same all the time. I was bored. So the only thing I could do was think, you don't want that to happen because that's when this happens. And the problem with such an introduction is it sets the bar quite high. So be prepared, it will go downhill fast from here. I do want to thank my wonderful son, Timon Cornelis, who is already a much better man than I will ever be. He composed the music, he recorded the music, and he even was able to record all the weird stuff I had written down without breaking into laughter. Thanks, Timon. Also, a lot of links for all the other credits. I do need to ask you to silence your cell phones. And please, not now, not today. Enjoy the day now. But when you're back home, explore all the other learning channels that PaaS has to offer. This is just one small tip of the iceberg, but there's so much more. You can be learning all year round. Yes, the first question already. I already started late, right? So I'm already running out of time.
Yeah, this is more a rumor or something. I think we need the volume up now.
Can you increase the volume a bit? Okay, thank you. So please do not forget to fill out your evaluations. The PaaS organization needs to know what you liked, what you didn't like. I've heard people say, why is there only one 500 level session this year? I've talked to that with people from PaaS, and they say there's not much demand. Why do they say that? Because that's the feedback they get. So if all of you think there should be more 500 level content, let them know, to counter the voices who say there's still too much 500 level content and the wrong idiot is delivering it. Well, maybe you agree with that part. So let them know. Also, I want your feedback. If you think this was the best, will have been the best session ever, let me know. It gives me a good 5 minutes and then I move on with my life. If you think it really sucked, let me know. I will have a terrible 5 minutes and I will move on with my life. Or you can tell me why it sucked, and then I will try to get better the next time. So especially if you think my session is not good, let me know what I did wrong, please. So, a half day session about HashMatch the operator. Did I already mention that it's a bad idea to give me too much time to think? The idea for this session started when I was bored. And somehow in my head I started, Has anyone ever done a complete 1 hour or 75 minute presentation on a single show plan operator? I don't think that has ever been done. Would it be possible? So I started thinking, nested loops, it's an interesting operator, but 75 minutes, no. Compute scalar, not, it's too boring. Table spool, well, perhaps, or hash match. And then the ideas started flowing. And by the time I had finally something to do, something really useful to do, I realized a single session on hash match is possible, but it will be a challenge. The challenge will not be to fill out a complete session. The challenge will be to keep it within one session. And if you have checked the schedule, you will know that I have failed. It's a double session. And the last time I delivered, I ran over. And now I started 5 minutes late. By the way, a huge thank you for the AV people who, under enormous pressure, in just a few minutes managed to repair everything that was wrong. I don't know what was wrong. They repaired everything, and it cost me only 5 minutes, so thank you. What we are going to talk about today is HashMatch, the operator. I'm going to start with a theoretical foundation on hashing. What is hashing? What is a hash function? What is a hash table? And most of all, how did Microsoft build their version of the hash table? I'm also going to talk about all the logical operations, 11 or 12 or 13, depending on how you define some things. It's a bit weird, we'll get to that. Those two agenda items will be roughly the first half of the session before the break. And to be honest, this session is advertised as a 500 level session. I think that first hour is more a 400 level session on average. But to make up for that, the second hour will be 600 level. And in the second hour, I will talk about all the issues with memory usage. If you are the person who thinks, oh dear, my hash match spilled, now my performance is bad and I need to fix it, and that's all I want to know, then the second hour is probably not for you. Because in the second hour, I'm going to detail exactly what happens when your hash match spills, and all the phases it can go through. So I'll start at a bad point and then make it worse and worse and worse. And you'll be probably very nauseated by the time I finish, just before lunch. So we'll talk about all that. We'll talk about sharing memory between multiple operators, and we'll talk about hash teams. And by the way, hash teams is not a term for a DEA enforcement unit. I will also put a short disclaimer right now. Everything I'm going to talk about these next 2.5 hours, none of it will be immediately usable. Do not expect to walk away from here with an immediate list of things you can do next week in your office. This is a deep dive into the internals of an operator. I'm going to show a lot of things that are not documented. And I'm not going to show a debugger to prove that I'm right. I'm not going to use undocumented trace flags. I am going to run queries using only documented stuff and show you how the output from those queries support the things I'm saying. So I am presenting undocumented features, but I'm also giving you the code that you can run on your own system to verify whether you agree with me or not. I will not run all the demos. There's simply too much demos and not enough time, but I will go through the most important demos. You can run all of them on yourself. I have already made the material available through the PaaS website. Some of you may already have downloaded it, but I want you to know my sessions are constantly evolving. I have been working on this over the past days again. I have the most recent version of the deck and the demo code uploaded to my own website, sqlserverfast.com. So if you want to have the most recent version, the version I'm using today, go to sqlserverfast.com, click on the resources link, and find the deck and the demo code there. That's enough of a preamble. Let's dive in and start with the theoretical foundation. We're going to talk about hash match, so we're going to do a lot of hashing. And what the hell is hashing? Well, hashing is just like sorting the laundry. Oh, that doesn't convince you? Okay. My wife and I have a distribution of duties. She makes sure everything is clean, and I make sure it all gets folded, ironed, and put into the closet. And in the case of socks, yeah, I'm a procrastinator. So this is what I'm often faced with. Now, when I finally find the time, or when my wife yells at me loud enough that I start doing stuff, I do not just pick a sock and I go through the entire heap to find the other matching sock. I use a two-phase approach. And the first phase has this result. And I see people nod, so I immediately know who here in the room does their own laundry and who has someone else do it for them. And this is hashing. This is exactly what hashing is. I take a sock, I look at it, and I say, oh, this should go on the pile of the whites. This should go on the pile of the blues. And obviously, there are socks that are bluish gray or grayish blue, and sometimes I miss those. That's where the hashing, in my case, is imperfect. The perfect hashing uses numerical functions. So a hash function is a function that a computer can run, or a human being, if it takes a lot of time, but a human being can do it, on any type of input. Integers, characters, daytimes, socks, anything. The result will be an integer with a known range. Typically zero to a high number, because we all love to zero-based counting. Except me, I don't like it, so I will use one to a higher number in most of my examples. And that integer corresponds to the heap of to the stack of socks. Number one is the whites, number one, two is the yellows, number three is the blues, number four is the Mickey Mouse socks, etc., etc. It has to be deterministic. So the same input always has to yield the same output. That's where the bluish gray sock sometimes fails in my analogy. And then there's a thing called hash collisions. Ideally, what you want in the perfect hash function is that the same value goes to the same, gets the same hash value, and a different input value gets a different hash value. But that's not always achievable, especially if your range of output is less than your range of input. If you have 20,000 possible inputs and only 2,000 possible outputs, there's no way you can avoid two different inputs getting the same output. That's called a hash collision. A hash collision means two different input values return the same output value. The reverse can never happen. You can never have the same input value return a different output value, because that would break the deterministic property of a hash function. Cool. We know what hashing is. We know what a hash function is. Now, what is a hash table? A hash table means that you have a table where all your data is organized. Well, that's a concept we all know. But now it's not organized in a clustered index or in a heap. It's organized by the hash value. So for every possible hash value, there is a separate area where you store the data, a separate stack of socks. Or, as it's called in computer science, a separate bucket. Why is this called a bucket? Because the first professor who ever explained it didn't do his own laundry. So he used a set of buckets on stage and put items of paper in those physical buckets to illustrate the process. And the term hash bucket has stuck ever since. If he had been more emancipated, we would not be stuck with that name now. SQL Server stores the hash table entirely in memory, 100%. Now, if you Google for a hash table, you will see that there's lots of different implementations that all have the same purpose of implementing a hash table in different ways. I am not interested in all the possible ways. I'm only interested in how SQL Server does it. The documentation that Microsoft provides here is very limited. I found a tiny bit, and then I had to piece all the rest together. So I'll first show you how SQL Server stores and builds data in a hash table. And then I will, after that, run a demo where you can see how, by running a simple query, you can verify that this undocumented description is actually correct. So when SQL Server allocates a hash table, the first thing it does is that for every possible outcome of the hash function, it will allocate a structure that holds 7 pointers. Like this. And just to avoid any confusion, the bytes in memory are not actually colored. That's just me making a point, and I'll show the point later, because that 7th pointer is a bit special. Now, if you look here, you will see that there is nothing to explain or to indicate for which hash value each bucket, each pointer structure is. The reason is because it's always adjacent. It's a single contiguous block of memory. So what SQL Server can do when it needs to find the structure for hash value 4, it says, okay, I know where structure 0 starts. I know that each structure is 7 pointers long. So I add the length of 4 times 7 pointers, and that's where number 4 is. For our perusal, I have now added the numbers so that we don't have to count every time, but those are not actually stored anywhere. Clear so far? Good. SQL Server starts adding rows. It starts building a hash table. So it has a row somewhere, maybe in a buffer pool, maybe in working memory. The row itself remains there. The row is not moved. But a pointer to that row is added. So for this specific data row, assume that the hashing function returned the value 4. SQL Server finds the structure for value 4 and adds a pointer to the row in the first slot. Done. The row is now logically part of the hash table. Next row, let's hash the value and add it to the correct structure. Cool. Next row, hash the value, and again we have 4. Now SQL Server sees that the first slot is occupied, so it puts a pointer in the second slot. Done. That's all there is to it. At first. Because one day you may have data where you have more than 6 rows for the same bucket. Let's say that at this point we have pointers in various buckets and we read row number 7 that goes to bucket 4. We're not going to write it in the yellow pointer because it's yellow. We don't like to write in yellow pointers. So what SQL Server does is it allocates a new, fresh 7 pointer structure. Not in the same contiguous memory, just somewhere where it can find memory. It says, okay, I can allocate a pointer to the row here, but I need to be able to find this. So this is where the yellow pointer comes in. The last pointer is not a pointer to a row, but a pointer to the next structure. So you get a linked list of those structures. And now it has place to add a row here. And let's say that we have already 12 rows for hash value 4. Now, what will happen when we add row number 13? A lot of people would expect that the same happens as before. We create a new structure, and we'll link to it from the end of the second structure. But there's a performance problem there. Because if you have millions of rows in a single bucket, you don't want that, but it can happen. If you have millions of rows in a single bucket, then that linked list keeps getting longer and longer. And every time SQL Server adds a row, it starts in the basic block, because that's the location it can compute, and then it would have to follow all those pointers. And even though it's in memory, following a million pointers in memory still takes a considerable time, maybe even hundreds of nanoseconds. So what Microsoft did instead was they said, yes, we're going to allocate a new pointer structure, but we are not going to add it to the end, we're going to add it in the middle. So first, the new structure gets a pointer to what was the second pointer, and then the pointer in the base block is relocated to point to the new structure. So now we see that the first 6 rows are allocated in the base structure, that is in the contiguous block. The next 6 rows go into a new structure, and then it inserts a structure between rows 6 and 7. And it adds 6 rows there. And then it will again insert a structure between rows 6 and 7, or 6 and 13, effectively, and add 6 rows there. And that's the order in which SQL Server will keep building. So every time it has to insert a row, it will only need to go to the base structure, check if it's full, follow a single pointer, check if that's full, and if that's full, it can immediately allocate a new structure, and it will never have to traverse the rest of the chain anymore. Let's see a demo, because none of you should believe this without seeing evidence, right? You don't trust me, correct? If you do, you're wrong. It helps to click to the correct place. So I have a demo script that I will kick off. This is the preparation script that takes about a minute on my 2017 instance, because I'm running on SSD. On a spinning disk, it takes a lot longer. What I do here is create simple tables called build input and probe input with a big int key, a character key, and a large filler. That's all. The probe input is the same. And then I create a huge amount of data by having a numbers CTE that produces 500,000 rows, and having a letters CTE that produces the letters A, B, D, F, and G, cross joins that for the build input. For the probe input, I do the same numbers, but I do the letters A, C, D, E, and G. And then I create some additional tables that I don't even fill for one other demo. So the execution has run, the data is there. And for this demo, I had a chicken egg problem, because logically I wanted to explain the hash table first. But this demo requires you for now, at this time, to at least believe one claim. To believe my claim that the query I'm going to run will show you the order of the hash table. Later, I will have multiple demos where I make that claim credible. But I need you to trust me for now. So switch to the correct table. What I do here is I use the first 10,000 rows from the build input with the predicate on the key, ordered by key 1 and then by key 2. I have an empty probe, key 1 less than 0, doesn't happen. And I do a left join. So the output will be everything in the build input that is not matched, because nothing is matched. And like I said, I will later explain to you why this reveals the structure of the hash table. If I run this, and I will first look at the execution plan. And in the execution plan, you will see a clustered index seek that is ordered. Why? Because it has to use this ordering, and it doesn't need to sort this way. A top doesn't affect the order of rows. So I now know for sure, by looking at the execution plan, that the rows flowing into the build input of the join operator, of the hash match join operator, are entering in order of sorting by key 1 and then by key 2. The probe input is empty, so I can ignore it, and SQL Server will output some results. And by the way, I will not use as many hints as I do here in production code. All the hints I use here is just because I want specific execution plans. They are not efficient query plans. The query plans to demonstrate some stuff. So please don't go spreading hints through your production code and then adding in the comments, I did this because Hugo told me to. I told you not to. So look at the results. We will see data in some interesting order. This appears sorted. This appears sorted as well. But there is something missing in between. Hash functions affect order. They randomly scatter stuff around. But if I look further, and I need to look at the correct comments to see where I need to look. If I look here, starting at 16, you will see it starts with 46 A, B, D, F, G, the normal ordering, 250 A, and then we suddenly see a jump. 700 T, 10, D, F, G. Then we jump back to 215 B, D, F, G, 710 A, 710 B. These three values, 46, 215, and 710, were a hash collision. They're in the same bucket. And now we can see the order in which the rows were processed was this row first. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I know from the execution plan, this was row 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And then row 13 goes between row 6 and 7. If we look at a place with a larger hash collision, I need to scroll down to 906. And here we see the same structure, but now for four values that collide. 32A, B, D, F, G, 364A. Now I need to scroll quite a lot to find 364B, D, E, F, G, 573A, B. Scroll up, D, F, G, 659A, B, D, and then we had another full container. So we inserted yet another container in between. So we keep adding a container for six rows in between the first block of six that's fixed and the rest of the chain. And this output confirms this. Now you may wonder, how do I know which values are hash collision and which values are not? I mean, in the comments, I say bucket, there is a bucket with one value for zero, and there is a bucket with two values for 23 and 687. But if you look at the output, how can I prove that this is not one bucket, a second bucket, and a third bucket? Could be just as well, right? And how did I find all these buckets? Did I pour over the output row by row to find this? Well, what I actually did was use the same query that also hashes by key one here, but now I order by key two first and then key one. So this is the only thing I changed between the two queries. So now I know that the input into the build input is sorted differently. And now look what happens. This is the first bucket. And here we see the second bucket. And now you suddenly see that the rows were inserted in the order we expected them. And I highlight them all, but it's actually the first six rows, and then the second four, and that second container never filled up. And using this output actually enabled me to rather quickly say, oh, here's two letters, so that's a hash collision of two values. Here the A is repeated three times, so that's a hash collision of three values. And on SQL Server 2016, I even had an occurrence where there were five values in the bucket. But when I upgraded to 2017, that didn't happen anymore. And the highest on my machine was four. I don't know how machine-dependent the hash function is. So when you run this on your machine, you may find different places. But the second query can help you find the hash collisions in your data. And then the first query can help you gain visibility in how the buckets are filled. Questions so far? Yes?
The data types in the hash buckets, in the pointers, are those memory pointers or?
The structures I showed, so these structures, all these black dots, all these black dots are memory pointers. Yes? Correct. We now know how a hash table is built internally. How the SQL Server used that. That's where we are going to talk about all the logical operations. But first, in generic, if you look in the documentation that Microsoft did make available about HashMatch, you will see that it has two phases. Wrong. It has three phases. The official phases are the build phase and the probe phase, and I have discovered that there's also a third phase called the final phase. Maybe Microsoft considers that a part of the probe phase, but I care to disagree because it can also run when the probe phase doesn't run. So I consider it a separate phase that is not documented by Microsoft, but it is needed to produce the correct results. So let's look at each of those phases. The build phase is always used. Build phase is where the build input is processed. That's the input you find at the top in the graphical execution plan. This is the phase where the hash table is built. So everything it reads from the build input is stored in memory, in the structure we have seen. In almost every case, the build phase does not produce any output. After that, we have the probe phase. And the probe phase is not always used. It's used for most logical operations, but not for aggregation, for scalar aggregate, or for flow distinct. Those logical operations do not have a probe input, so there is no probe phase. All the other operations do have a probe input, and that is processed during the probe phase. What is done in the probe phase is the data is read, then SQL Server searches in the appropriate bucket in the hash table for matches and produces the correct data. And then, when needed, the final phase is run, and that's only done in the case of a left outer join, a left semi-join, a left anti-semi-join, or in the case of aggregation. This is where data is returned from the hash table. This is also the trick I used in the previous demo. If you look at the hash match operator in the execution plan, and I apologize in advance, this is the only slide that contains useful information. If you look at the hash match operator in an execution plan, there are some properties you want to look at. The hash keys build specifies which columns are the input for the hash function to determine the hash bucket. The hash keys probe determines the columns that are the input for the probe phase. But there's also a set of columns that will be hashed using the same hash function to find the correct bucket. And then you might find a probe residual, which specifies the additional tests to verify whether a row in the appropriate bucket is actually a match or is not a match. And not being a match can be because of a hash collision, or it can be because of additional predicates. For instance, a hash match join. If you have a hash match join on A equals B and C is less than D, then A equals B will be used to determine the hash function. And that is evaluated using the hash algorithm. But C less than D, inequality cannot be tested with a hash match algorithm. So that is an additional test carried out after finding potential matches in the hash table. And I have a quick demo on those probe residuals. Because it's interesting to look when probe residuals are needed and when not. So I've used very simple query where, and I'm not interested in the query, I'm interested in what the probe residual is if I join on only key one, which is an integer. And if I look at the estimated execution plan here, you will see that there is a probe residual here. I think I misspoke, key one is a big int, because otherwise this would be incorrect. If I join on only a char one column, or car one, or care one, or however you want to pronounce it, I don't car, care, or chair, then you will see that there is also a probe residual. It's a single byte character, but because it's a character, there can be all kind of shenanigans with, how do you call them? Collations, thank you, I knew you would save me, because you love them. So this is where the other smaller tables come in, because I wanted to try a variety of data types. So here I'm joining on integer columns. And the interesting thing is, when I join on integer columns, there is no probe residual anymore. And that's because, in this case, SQL Server can guarantee a collision-free hash algorithm. And if there are guaranteed no collisions, then there is no need to test for collisions. For a small int and a tiny int, we will see the same thing, that there is no collision. If we do, for instance, two tiny ints, or even a small int plus two tiny int columns, like here, and we look, then there is still no additional test needed, so no risk of collisions. But as soon as I go to five bytes, an integer plus a tiny int, the probe residual will return in the plan. So four bytes integer data type is the maximum that SQL Server can guarantee to be collision free. It gets interesting if I use incompatible data types. So here I have an integer and a small int. There will be some conversion. The end effect will be two integers, but after a conversion. And because of that conversion, we suddenly do get a probe residual. It shouldn't be needed, but it's still there. An explicit cast does not change that. In fact, even if I use data two is a small int, I cast this as a small int, a no-op. Data two from the other table is also a small int, which I cast as a small int. And I'm going to join on that. Guess what happens? SQL Server says, oh, you did database conversions, I'm going to do a probe residual, because I don't trust the data anymore as soon as you did conversions. So using all these tests, I came to the conclusion that a probe residual is needed when there is any type of operation on the columns, because then SQL Server doesn't trust the data anymore. Probe residual is also needed when you use non-integer data types. And there is a list of data types there that they did not test, because my time is not endless. But you have the code, you can test it yourself using the same code. When you use a non-equality join, that was the last demo that I skipped, where A equals B and C larger than D, then you will also, of course, get a probe residual. But the interesting part is that A equals B will then be included in the probe residual, even if it would not be there if you had not included C larger than D. And finally, if you have an equality conditions on only integer, small int, and tiny int with a combined size of 4 bytes or less, then you will not get a probe residual. Questions? I think you had your hand up. How much impact does a probe residual have on the operation minimal? It's just an extra test that SQL Server has to run when it finds a potential match. So it's a few CPU cycles per row. Yes, one more question, two more questions, and then I'm moving on. Did you see the list of data types that I didn't test? But let me know once you have tested it. Yes.
So there's no residual when there are no collisions to be guaranteed?
Yep. When there's no probe residual, that means that SQL Server knows for sure that there will be no collisions and that there is no other reason to do an additional test. OK, moving on. The build phase, in almost all cases, follows the same logic. And it's a very simple logic. It's a very simple flow diagram. It initializes the build input, it grabs a row, and it checks whether it got a row or an end of data signal. When it gets a row, it computes the hash, and it simply stores the row in the appropriate bucket. We already saw how that works. Then it grabs the next row, and it keeps doing that. That's all there is to it. So after all the groundwork I laid, this is very simple. Now that we had all the rest. Once the build phase is completed, this means that the entire build input will be completely in memory. Frankly, I'm surprised that nobody has raised their hand yet and said, what about spills? Spills is for the next hour. So this entire first half of the session, we are going to live in the magical fairy tale world where spills never happen. Okay, bear with me. We're going to be extremely happy this entire time. And to compensate, I will make all of you very sad in the next half of the session. So we have the build phase, it has completed. Now let's look at an inner join during the probe phase. The simplest of all operations, in my opinion, is the inner join. The inner join starts the probe phase by initializing the probe input, grabbing a row, and looking, do I even get a row? If there is no row there, if the probe input is empty, well, this will be a very boring session. But let's assume there's a row. It will now compute the hash, and based on that hash, it knows in which bucket it can find any matches that there may be, plus, of course, the hash collisions, the fake matches. So it will then search the bucket, apply the probe residual as needed, and if it finds a match, it returns the joined row. Now, a simplification I use in my flow charts is that I pretend that this just keeps going. That's not true. When the joined row is returned, the operator is done. It stores some data to remember where it is, it returns the row, and another operator starts to do some work. Eventually, that other operator will say, oh, I need more data, and it will call the hash match operator again and say, give me another row. And at that point, the logic will continue to run. I'm going to explain this only once, I just did that. But this is the disclaimer that you should keep in mind for every one of my flowcharts. Wherever it says return row, execution is interrupted until the operator is called again. So when that happens, the operator will continue to look in the same bucket to see if there are more matches, because there is no guarantee that there's only a single match in the build input. There may be multiple. So it has to search the entire bucket and produce joined data for every match it finds. And then once the probe row is completely processed, and the entire build input has been searched and all matches have been returned, it continues to the next probe row. Now, what if we change this to a right outer join? And not all projectors work well with the colors, but it should be purple what I changed. I hope the change is the color is visible. The only thing that happens is that when the entire bucket is searched and there is no match found, there will still be something returned. The probe row on itself with nulls for the build values that needs to be returned, as you would expect from a right outer join. And that's the only change. So when you review how this works, this means that during the build phase, the operator is blocking. It's doing a lot of work, but no rows are being returned to the client. If you look at the probe phase, the operator is streaming. Every row that is read is immediately resulting in output for the next operator to be processed. And I hope we all know that if you have an execution plan where all operators are streaming, that means that you get your first data immediately and just keep receiving data, whereas blocking operators in your execution plan are the result, cause a query to do nothing for 2 seconds and then suddenly start barfing data. There is no final phase for the inner join or the right outer join. And when I say the order of the rows from the probe input is retained, that is in the happy, magical unicorn world we are living in now. The optimizer knows that there are no happy, magical unicorn rainbow worlds. So the optimizer doesn't consider this as an order retaining operation. Now, why order retention is important is completely irrelevant for this session. So I'm not going to pound on why this is important. But for the optimizer, it is important to know what operators retain order and what operators don't. The hash match doesn't, according to the optimizer, because there are scenarios where it doesn't. But in our happy unicorn world, the probe input will not change order during the probe phase. Let's look at the demo. And I have demos for all the join operators, but I'm not going to show them all. Like I said, you can run a lot of those demos on your own system later. So I use a very simple structure of a query, similar to what we've seen before. I use a top input where I use a top and an order by to force that the order is as I want it to be. I do the same thing for a probe, so now I have data in the probe. Then I do an inner join, and I have some hints to force that it works the way I want to. First, need to be in the correct database. I can check in the execution plan, and trust me, I've done this for all the queries. I'm not going to show it for all the queries, but for all the queries, I check that it is an ordered scan, that there is nothing that affects the order here. So I check the build and the probe are where I expect them to, that I get the correct join type. You can, of course, check that all on your own, but I do not have the time to show it for every query I'm going to run. If I execute this query, you will see when you look at the data that it is all sorted. So this does not prove that the order of the probe data is retained. It proves that the order of the probe or the build is retained. That's the only thing I can prove right now. I'm telling you that it's the probe. If I change the inner join to a right join, and I look again, then it gets more credible that the probe order is retained because these nulls are out of order. But these values are not. So here you actually see by looking at the result set that the data that is flowing during the probe phase is completely retaining the order of the probe rows, which supports the diagram I just showed. Let's move on to the left outer join. Somehow in my work, the left outer join seems to be the most popular join type, even when an inner join would be sufficient. People like to type a left outer join because reasons. Anyway, the left outer join is slightly more complex. During the probe phase, it does the same thing as an inner join, but there's one thing added. It marks the row inside the bucket. Adds a mark saying, hey, this row from the bucket has been used to perform an output already. It can be used multiple times, then the mark will be set multiple times, but it's a simple bit. So change a 0 to 1 or change a 1 to 1, the result will be a 1. So why is this done? Because we need to know which rows in our hash table are not matched to anything. The only thing to know this is to track which rows are matched. And then we can, at the end, when the left outer join has completed its probe phase, say, okay, now we're going to scan the entire hash table, and every row in the hash table that has not had this mark set apparently didn't find a match, so it has to be output now. And this is the trick I used in the first demo, where I made sure to control the input to the build phase and then joined to an empty table, or to an empty input. So there were no marks set, and it got visibility into the entire hash table and in the order in which the hash table was in memory. For a full outer join, it is again the same thing, except that just like the difference between inner and right outer join, we also need to return unmatched probe rows. So here we see basically the same thing as for the inner and the right outer join, a blocking build phase, a streaming probe phase that in our magical fairy tale world retains the order, and then adds a final phase where you get rows in random order. It's not really random. If you are really determined, you can try to reverse engineer the hash function by looking at those rows. I'm not that determined. I'm quite determined, but I have my limits. So if we look at this demo, I'm just going to skip immediately to the full outer join. If we look at the full outer join, you will see that the first page of data is the same as with the right outer join. You will see no difference. This appears to be the right outer join data, and it's still ordered by the probe data, until I hit the end of that, and then suddenly we get the remaining rows that were retained from the left table and not matched, and there really is no discernible order here. This is just the order in which they are after hashing the key values. So that appears to be random to us. I think the first block ends at 10:45, right? Good. So, let's move to the left semi-join. Okay, hands up, who does not know what a semi-join is? Good. Who does not know what an exists is? No hands? Good. Now you all know what a semi-join is. Semi-join means, or the left semi-join means, read something from the left logically. Implementation may be different, but logically means for every row from the left input, search for matches in the right output. If there is at least one, output the row from the left input. If there is none, forget about it. Exists. It's exactly the same. If you write exists in your query, 99 out of 100 times you will find a left semi-join somewhere in your query plan. If you find a left semi-join in your query plan, 8 out of 10 times you will have an exists somewhere in your query. And otherwise you will have a construction that is logically equivalent. So what the left semi-join does is basically the same as the left outer join, except that it doesn't output any matches. It just looks for matches. So it reads something from the probe data, checks whether it finds it in the hash bucket, and if yes, it sets that mark. I found a match. But I don't care about that probe input, because probe input is the right data. We are not returning the right data. We're only returning the left data. And at the end, after doing all that work, it can return all the marked rows at once. This is not the only possible way this could have been implemented. In fact, when I started building my slides, I already had a complete flowchart for how I thought it would be implemented in a more efficient way. And then I ran my demo, and it turned out that the results showed that this is the way that Microsoft implemented it. There's also a left anti-semi-join. Who does not know what an anti-semi-join is? Who does not know what a not exists is? Done. It's the reverse. So it also works the same. It marks rows and it finds matches, but now it doesn't return the marked rows, it returns the unmarked rows. That's the only difference. So it's a very simple variation on the same algorithm, to get a different result set. So this means that the left semi-join and the left anti-semi-join are completely blocking. They are blocking in the build phase, but they're also blocking in the probe phase. Because during the entire probe phase, nothing is output. All the output is produced in the final phase. And like I said, for the left semi-join, not for the anti-semi-join, but for the left semi-join, there is a theoretic other possibility that I would personally have expected, where the rows are output as soon as the mark is set, and then when it is set, they're not output again because SQL Server can see that the mark is already set, and you do not need a final phase. That would have been flowing during the probe phase, so I would have preferred that, but Microsoft apparently chose to build it this way. I think that has to do with code simplicity and code reuse, and reducing the different number of code paths within the operator, but that's just speculation on my part. I'm going to skip this demo. You can run a lot of your demos yourself. Yes?
Yeah, I was just thinking, if you would do it that way you suggest, they would need two bits. So you would have, as this bit, this has been attached to all, has been attached to all the output.
Berlin says you need two bits. I understand his logic, but it's not correct, because you can check the bit whether a match has been found before you set it. So if the match bit was not set, you output the row and then set it. If the bit was set, you do nothing. If there is a left semi-join, then of course there's also a right semi-join. It does the same logic, but with your inputs reversed. And here, the logic is even simpler. Base idea of the flow chart is still the same. We search the bucket for matches. And if we find a match, we return the row from the probe. We do not return the joint result. We only return the row from the probe. But you will notice that searching for additional matches has been removed from this flowchart. Why? Because I don't care whether there are more matches. I'm not going to return the row multiple times. So I can search for them and then do nothing with the result, or I cannot search for them. Admittedly, without attaching a debugger, I cannot prove that Microsoft doesn't waste cycles by searching for additional matches and then ignoring them. But I've talked to a lot of people at Microsoft, and most of them are pretty smart. So I think they did it like this. For the right anti-semi-join, well, the same thing happens. Do you find a match? Then you don't need to do anything more. As soon as you find a single match, you know, I don't care about this row anymore. If you go through the entire bucket and you do not find any match, well, that's a row you're interested in, you're going to return it. Make sense? So, again, this is one of the many cases where HashMatch is streaming in the probe phase. Ideally, in the happy-peppy world, retaining the order from the probe input. And there are some other theoretic possibilities. And in this case, the theoretic possibility that I personally thought might have been more interesting was to remove duplicates from the build input. If you don't care about the same row, the same match being found multiple times, why would you even store it multiple times? Why not just store one copy of the row instead of multiple copies? If you run, I will show this demo, that part of the demo, because that's easier to show than to explain, because I wanted to make sure how Microsoft chose to implement that. And what I did for that is look at a right outer join where all the duplicates are needed. In this case, I join on key one only, but of course there are duplicates in key one. We have five letters for each value of key one. Join on key one only, so there's five duplicates for each row. This is a right outer join, so we actually need all those. And of course, they need to be stored. So now, if I look at the hash match, or rather, if I look at the memory grant, you will see that the memory grant, the expected amount of memory needed is 1888 kilobytes. And I also look at memory usage. And if I look at the memory grant info, I can see that the maximum used memory is 776 kilobytes. So that's the amount of memory needed to store this amount of data with all five copies for each key one value. Now, if we hope that when we change this to a right semi-join, right anti-semi-join, we could consider maybe it stores only one of those five copies. Then we would use less memory. because storing one copy instead of five is simply less memory. But I looked at the execution plan, and I see that the memory grant is the same. So maybe it's a bug in the memory grant algorithm, but the actual usage is less. Well, let's check that as well. Luckily, we get all that information right now. And we also see that the same amount of memory is used. So based on this, I can see that without having to attach a debugger or anything, I can just see for sure that all those duplicates are stored. And there's probably reasons for that related to more complex join conditions. I can see that, but now I know for sure. Then we have the union operator. What does union do? The same as union in T-SQL. It returns everything for the first result set, plus everything for the second result set, not side by side, but there's more rows, while removing all duplicates. Now, the hash match algorithm is terrible at removing duplicates from the probe input. So it doesn't. Union can only be used when the optimizer can guarantee that your probe input is already free of duplicates. But the algorithm can identify duplicates in the build input, and it can identify duplicates between the two inputs, rows that with one copy in the build and one copy in the probe that become a duplicate after combining them. So here the probe phase, and again, there are multiple ways that this cat could have been petted, but Microsoft chose to do it this way. So here the trick is, it searches, it processes the probe phase, looks for whether that row already exists in the build input, and if it does, it ignores the row. And if it doesn't, it returns the probe row. So the first phase, the probe phase, only returns rows from the second input that have no match in the first input. And then the final phase goes over the hash table to return everything there, excluding duplicates, which means to exclude the duplicates, it has to search the bucket, either sort it or do some method to remove the duplicates from each bucket. But the bucket should have only a few rows, so that's rather efficient. Now, again, there are several variations possible. You could change this algorithm to return data that is matched during the probe phase already, with some additional logic to mark what has been returned there and then only return the rest later. Then you would get more data in the probe output, more streaming data, less data at the end. Microsoft doesn't do it that way. You could change the build algorithm to remove duplicates and reduce the size of your hash table. But using the same method I showed before, in the demo you will see the code I used, but it's the same basic method. Just look at the size of the memory grant, look at the used memory, and you will see that duplicates are stored in the hash table and are only removed during the output phase. Those are all the join-like types. Oh, by the way, I'm skipping this demo, but one of the demos is where I force SQL Server to do a union between two data sets that do have duplications. And you're wondering, how does SQL Server do that? Does it throw an error? No, it adds an extra operator in the probe input to remove the duplicate. So there's a sort distinct there, or a hash match distinct. I don't recall which one it does. So those were all the logical operations that have two inputs. But hash match can only have one, it can also have one input. And then it also returns correct results for something completely different. This is the Tootsie part of the talk. A lot of people actually think that a hash match aggregate is not the same as a hash match. And they think when you talk about hash match that you're joining. It's the same operator. So when you do aggregation, that's when the build phase changes. Now we suddenly have a different build phase. So yes, the basic outline is still the same. Read something from the build input, hash the key values, and instead of adding it to the bucket, the algorithm will now search through the bucket and try to see do we already have a row for this specific key value? If yes, then it will not add anything to the bucket. It will update the row in the bucket. If no, then it will create that row and then update it. So the row that is created for every specific key value holds the value of the key columns needed to detect whether the row is a hash collision or not, and placeholder for the aggregates so far. So what is there exactly depends on the aggregates you ask. If you ask for a count star or a count big star, there will be a counter that is initialized at zero when the row is created, and updated, increased by one whenever the same row is updated. If you have a minimum in your output, then you will have a row that is initialized with a null. And whenever a row is processed, if the value that you are determining the minimum of is not a null, it will be compared to what is the current minimum, and then the new minimum will be stored there. If you have a sum, then the value will be added to what you have there currently, and so on. So as we are processing rows, these aggregates contain the aggregates of all the rows processed so far. So what happens when you process all the rows? Now suddenly your hash table contains all the key values and all the aggregates you wanted to have. So what do we do now? Well, we return that to the client. That's all. Yes, question. How does it deal with hash collisions? That is dealt with in the test match found. So let's say that the key value is a London. It's hashed to the value 17, so it looks in bucket 17. And then there's two rows there, and the first row, it looks at the row, and the key value there says New York, because that happens to be a hash collision. I'm not interested. Second row, London. Ah, that's the one I need to update. And if the second had been Bangalore, then it would now create a third row. Make sense? Okay, sure. So the hash match aggregate is blocking in the build phase. And now it doesn't store everything. It doesn't store the entire build input in your hash table. It only stores the intermediate aggregated data. There is no probe phase. But there is a final phase when all the output is returned to the client in semi-random order, because it's your hash table. I'm going to skip this demo too, but in this demo you will see the order, and there are some queries you can run to look at the different memory grants and memory usages, depending on whether you group by a column with lots of distinct values or few distinct values. So there you will see that indeed the amount of memory used shrinks and is based on the number of distinct key values. And then there's the flow distinct. How many of you have ever seen a hash match flow distinct in real production code? Not in demo code, but in real production code. I see one, two. Okay, that's approximately two more than I would have expected, because it's extremely rare. It's an interesting operator. Here, the logic is, during the build phase, we search, we process a row, we hash the key values, we search the bucket. If a match is found, we do nothing. We don't care about that row, because there is a match there, so apparently we've seen this row before. If there's no match found, then we store it in the bucket, only to serve as a reminder we have seen these key values before. Then we return that row. Because we store it, the next time we see the same key values, we suddenly are on the path where a match is found. And we don't return it anymore. So here we have something that very few people would get correct on a pop quiz. Yes, a hash match operator can be streaming during the build phase, but only if you have a flow distinct. And yes, that means that the order of rows from the build input is now suddenly retained without guarantee. There's no probe phase, there's no final phase, it's only building. And once it's done and it has this beautiful hash table in memory, it just discards it because it's not interested anymore. That was only there to prevent duplicates from being output during the build phase. Now here's a problem. if you do a distinct in your query, let's do one step back. Select distinct city from customers is the same as select city from customers grouped by city. That sounds like an aggregate where you don't aggregate anything. There's no aggregation functions being used. The optimizer knows that. So when you type select distinct city from customers, chances are that you will see a hash match aggregate and not a hash match flow distinct. Why? Because even though the aggregation is supposed to also do counting and stuff like that, it doesn't need to do that. And it's cheaper than the flow distinct algorithm. So why is the flow distinct algorithm even there? If there is a cheaper alternative, that's always chosen. Because it flows. And that's where the benefit comes in. So it's used when the optimizer works towards a row goal. And this is a demo I do want to run. If I can find, I'm already in the correct screen. Note to self, switch glasses before trying to tap to the correct screen. So let's first look at these two queries and look at the execution plans. So the first execution plan uses flow distinct. The second uses hash match aggregate. If I run only the first execution plan and I enable live query statistics, you need to look very careful when I click because it is quite fast. But if you look, you will see, and I'm going to click it now, and I'm going to do it a few times. So you can see that while it's running, all operators are processing rows at the same time. Is that being visible to everyone? Do I need to repeat it a few more times, or did you see it? Now the second one has a hash match aggregate. And here, when I run this one, look at how the row counters do. You will see that the hash match aggregate first only receives data while the clustered index seek is being processing data. And then when the clustered index seek is done, the hash match aggregate starts outputting data. So there's the difference. The flow distinct flows and streams your data immediately. That means that SQL Server will use the flow distinct when it doesn't need to return everything. So here I have a large input and I have two slightly different queries. And I prepared this in advance, otherwise I would have been searching for the cutoff point a bit longer. But you see that this is the cutoff point. When SQL Server only wants the first 3,540 rows, then it will say, okay, I'm going to do a flow distinct. But when I want the first 3,541, it's going to say, okay, screw that, I'm going to do a hash match aggregate. Why? Because the estimated number of rows is less than 3,541, but more than 3,540. So SQL Server will only use the flow distinct when you ask for less rows than it thinks it will be able to give you. And then it says, oh, if you don't need all the rows, then I'm cheaper if I don't process all the rows. And you can also see the result here. This one was blocking, so it processed the entire input. And it expects to be to have to process 459,786 rows. But the estimator says, oh, if you're not going to return everything, then I can stop executing after processing 459,729 rows. So it shaves a tiny bit of performance time because the last few rows, based on the estimates, will not be read. You save some I.O. And obviously, if I change this 3540 to a much lower value, and if I actually hit the correct button when I try to do that, then it will say, oh, now I'm only going to read 4,700 rows, and then I will have those 35 distinct values and I don't need the rest anymore. Scalar aggregate, look for time. Yeah, the scalar aggregation will be after the break. I will resume at 11 sharp and I will release you after responding to Erlen's question.
Just quick, so why is the flow distinct actually more expensive than the
That's a great question. So Erland asks, why is the flow distinct more expensive? I think that has to do with some additional instructions. It has to do during the build phase that it doesn't have to do in a hash match aggregate. But then you'd have to look further under the cover than I can do without attaching a debugger or getting access to source control. And if I could get access to source control, I would immediately be disallowed from doing this presentation. So that's all I can give you. It's speculation. Yes. No, no. It's one of the demos I skipped. I type a group by, and because there's a top as well, you will see a flow distinct in the execution plan. So the optimizer knows that group by without aggregations and distinct are synonyms. So whatever you type, you get the same execution plan.
Right. So you don't have to go through your code.
No. Yes. Yes. That's generally the case for everything optimizer related. If two different queries can give the same plan, they will give the same plan. Until you start doing joins to 17 different tables, because then there is a point where the optimizer says, hey, I could spend 50 days going through all the alternatives, but you don't want me to do 50 days of optimization. So I'm just going to look at a subset. And then there is a chance that a rewrite of the query gives you a different plan because it has a different starting point of your search. But for smaller queries, the search will always touch all the possible plans, and a change of the query that doesn't affect the results should not affect the execution plans in simple queries. So I did go through all the real logical operations, but then there's the two weird ones. A logical operation that exists but doesn't exist, and a logical operation that doesn't exist but exists. Let's start with the latter. Did I already say that I'm going to increase the level a bit now? So we have in execution plans sometimes something that's called hash match aggregate, but it's not the same as hash match aggregate. Microsoft denies that this is something special, but it is something special. Hash match can do scalar aggregation. So what is scalar aggregation? Select count star from table, semicolon. No group by, just a single result. Why would you ever want to use hash match for that? Why not just use a stream aggregate? Far more efficient for a case like this, because there's only a single value going to be output. Are you going to set up a hash table to hold a single value? Well, yes, sometimes you do. Especially if you have ever ran select count star from very big table with column store on SQL Server 2012. And noticed that your query was running in row mode instead of in batch mode, because stream aggregate is not supported in batch mode. And Microsoft had a hard time explaining why select count star from big table was slower, and not a bit slower, but much slower, than select count star from table group by whatever column as a derived table, and then do a select sum from the results of that. So you had a huge complex query that ran much faster instead of the simple query, and Microsoft had a hard time explaining that. I don't blame them. I had a fun time mocking them for that. But unfortunately, they fixed it. So only for batch mode execution, hash match since SQL Server 2014 can now be used for what we call global aggregation or a scalar aggregate, an aggregation without group by. And this is only introduced to prevent a fallback to row mode, because stream aggregation is not supported in batch mode. I would actually say that a hash match aggregate in batch mode doing a scalar aggregation is sneaking in stream aggregation because it's working the same way, but okay. It's only a single bucket always because there's only a single row going to be output. If you're using, if you're in a parallel section, then you will get a single bucket per thread and they will be combined at the end. So if you look at an execution plan, you may see a hash match aggregate and the hash keys built is empty. So you're grouping by nothing. This means that you're actually doing a hash match scalar aggregate. The logic is different. It's doing something different because there is a hash table with only a single row in there. But SQL Server decided to call it hash match aggregate and pretend it's the same thing. That was the logical operation that exists, but doesn't. Now on to the logical operation that doesn't exist but does. So SQL Server will sometimes show you an execution plan that says, I am a hash match partial aggregate. And then you go like, hey, you can never mention partial aggregate as a logical operation. No, partial aggregate isn't a logical operation. It's the same as scalar aggregate, or sometimes the same as aggregate, depending on the use case. But it's labeled differently in the plan, even though it does the exact same thing. So specifically in the case of a partial aggregate doing a scalar aggregation, there is even some additional weird stuff going on. And I'm going to show that in a demo. So in the Contoso retail DW database, I have a query that does some aggregation. And on SQL Server 2012, this used to run in row mode, even though a column store table is being used. Now it can run in batch mode, as you can see here, based on a hash match here, but then also the hash match aggregate here. This hash match aggregate would fall back to row mode. And now it's batch mode. And if you look at the build input, you will see there is no build input. And you will also see that just a single row is being returned from this. This is labeled as aggregate, but it's doing something different because there's no group by. And a normal hash match aggregate needs a group by. Now I'm going to fiddle with the database compatibility level a bit because this repro is using a different method on 130 and up. But on 120, in this demo, you will see the hash match partial aggregate here. And what the hash match partial aggregate does is some data is combined in a parallel section. So you get, in my case, 8 nodes all working on their own subset of data, and then forming an aggregate. That aggregate is correct for their 1/8 of the data. That's what the partial aggregate does. And then it's brought together by a parallelism, and then you get a stream aggregate that combines those into the final aggregate. This is a typical optimization pattern called local global aggregation or partial aggregation. Microsoft decided to make this visible in the execution plan by saying this is a partial aggregate. So it is a logical description of what the aggregate does in the context of the execution plan. But what it actually does in this case is scalar aggregate. And I've also seen the same in cases where it does a normal aggregate. But in this specific case, there is, if I actually execute it, one more weird optimization going on, because if you look at the output here and you look at how it is distributed among the threads, you will see that each of the 8 threads has its own amount of data. So you would expect the hash match partial aggregate to output 8 rows and then the stream aggregate to condense that to 1. But if we look at the output here, we will see only 1 row and only 1 thread, thread 3. And if I run it again, come on, do what I want instead of what I say you need to do. If I run it again, it will most likely be on another thread. So you see it's now on thread 7. So I cannot predict which of the threads will do the work, but apparently there's some optimization. And I've seen this more often in batch mode operators. Batch mode operators break through the walls between the threads sometimes. And this partial aggregate in this specific context does that in a very violent way, meaning that the stream aggregate isn't actually needed anymore. I don't know why it's still there. Maybe there are cases where it doesn't work and that's why it's still there. But that's why you will sometimes see a partial aggregate which doesn't do anything different than an aggregate or a scalar aggregate, but it's labeled different because it has a logically different function within your query. And that concludes the part I wanted to conclude before the break. So I'm already running late. Whee! Let's talk about memory usage, because you may have noticed, but I've talked a lot about stuffing huge amounts of data in memory. And often, when I go look at actual servers in the actual world, there is not enough memory. Sometimes that results in those nice yellow triangles in the execution plans that we all love, right? It's an opportunity to tune. It's an opportunity to send a nice bill. To help the client. So let's talk about what happens if the hash match runs out of memory. So let's first start at how memory is managed. So when the query starts running, or rather when the query wants to start running, the first thing that happens is that the operating system tries to reserve the amount of memory that is outlined in the memory grant. I already showed that in a few of the demos in the first half, without much explaining, that you can see the memory grant. That's the amount of memory that the query wants to have so that it can run based on the amount of work it expects to have to do. And I also showed the memory grant info, where you can see more details of this memory grant broken down in various sub-properties. Now, one of the problems with the architecture of SQL Server is that the amount is fixed. Once this memory is allocated to the query, that's it. There is no going back for seconds. So what to do when you run out of memory? You want everything in memory. Cool. I have 100 gigabytes of memory. I have 200 gigabytes of data. I want it all in memory. Not cool anymore. Can I have more memory? No. Please, can I? No. So here's the problem. While the query is executing, you don't get additional memory. So if there's more memory needed than you have, Microsoft, when building the product, had exactly two options. Well, they had three, changing the architecture to allow additional memory to be allocated. But other than that, there were two options. One is fail the query with an error message saying, hey, I ran out of memory, fix something, and then retry. Microsoft decided they do not want to fail a query if they can conclude the query in any way. They want to minimize errors to only cases where there is no alternative. So they went for alternative number two, which is to use the almighty and always popular TempDB to provide additional storage. But here's the thing. You all are very smart people. You all paid attention, so you all remember me saying in the first hour, hash table is always completely stored in memory. And now I'm saying it's using TempDB. But it's not using TempDB for the hash table. But the hash table was overflowing memory. This is getting complex. So a bit more about the memory grant. I was getting a bit ahead, so I'm going to click back. One other issue with the memory grant that you should be aware of, because sometimes there are people who say, if spilling is so bad, why doesn't SQL Server just increase the memory grants? Just ask for 10 times the estimated memory to minimize the chance of spilling. Well, you're not the only user on the server, most of the time. And the memory grant that you request is reserved for you, so nobody else has access to it. So if Microsoft would actually increase all the memory grants by a factor of 10, your concurrency goes down. And you will see queries that have an actual runtime of 5 milliseconds, waiting for 5 seconds until they finally get the memory available. And then they're hogging all that memory, and other people are waiting for that memory. So you don't want those resources wasted. You don't want a huge overgrant, but you also don't want a too small grant. SQL Server 2017 has a fix for that in batch mode. SQL Server 2019 extends that to all modes. I explained that in my session yesterday. So get your DeLorean and go to my session for yesterday if you want to know more about that. Anyway, we are not talking here about how SQL Server can fix that. We want to know all the gory details of every nasty bit that's going on when you see that nice yellow triangle. Just those few pixels, there's a lot of story behind that. The short term is, When SQL Server spills to disk in HashMatch operator, it uses dynamic destaging. Don't forget your feedback forms. That was it. Oh, you don't know what it is. So, okay. Dynamic destaging is a term that encompasses four different methods of doing stuff. In-memory hash join, hybrid hash join, grace hash join, and a recursive hash join. Now, I say hash join all the times because these are the terms used in academic literature. Academic literature research is always focused on the hash join algorithms because they need to store the entire table in data, in memory. A hash aggregate stores far less data, so it's far less interesting to research that. But the same methods are used when a hash match aggregate or a hash match distinct flow has to spill to disk. It doesn't happen as often, but the same methods are implemented, and the term hash join is just the term. But it's the official term you will find in all the research papers. Now, if dynamic destaging with its first with those four components isn't complex enough, then we can also do dynamic role reserve. English is a hard language, much harder than this content. We can also do dynamic role reversal, and then this is the part that will really make all of you cry. I hope there is enough Kleenex distributed to smother the tears, bailout. And then there's bit vector filtering to ease the pain a tiny bit. Enough content for the next hour, I think. Let's go through all of this. Well, let's not talk about the in-memory hash join. Why not? Because we spent the entire previous hour on the in-memory hash join. The in-memory hash join is the unicorn rainbow happy world where we never are short of memory. So the in-memory hash join is what I described in the last hour, where everything always fits in memory and nothing bad ever happens. So let's move to the grace hash join, and the smart people here will realize that I skipped one term, and I did that on purpose. So I do them out of order. The grace hash join is the algorithm that is used when you know or expect that your amount of data to store in the hash table is more than the amount of available memory. In the case of this algorithm, what will happen is that we know the amount of buckets, and then those buckets are partitioned. So let's just use some numbers to make this a more realistic example, and the numbers are just simple numbers I use. Let's say that a hash match operator uses a hashing function with 20,000 possible outputs. And because I don't like C, it's 1 to 20,000, and not 0 to a number that would eat up way too much of my time. So we have 20,000 buckets, 1 to 20,000. And we expect that the data we will get will not fit in memory, but we also expect that it will not be by a huge factor. So we use some logic and say, what if instead of doing all those 20,000 buckets, we would do 5,000 buckets at a time? Now, the simplistic way would be to do buckets 1 to 5,000, 5,000 1 to 10,000, but who likes simplistic? So what happens in reality is that a partition function is set up, that a hash function is set up. So we already have a hash on your input data that results in a number of 1 to 20,000. Then we have a secondary hash function that uses a number of 1 to 20,000 as input and has a number of 1 to 4 as output. And that's the partition number. And we should make sure that those four partitions do fit in memory in the case of a grace hash join. Now we're going to create two files for each partition. So we had four partitions. This means we're creating 8 files. They're called files in the academic research papers where the grace hash join method is described. It could be implemented by actual physical files on the file system. SQL Server has its own method. It's called TempDB. But if you have ever studied stat statistics I output, yeah, I always say stat statistics I because I never see logical writes in the stat statistics I output. So if you ever studied the output, you will see that there's always your table names there. And then sometimes you have work tables, and sometimes you have work files. Anyone ever notice that difference? So work tables are, for instance, created when you have a table spool or an index spool. They create structures in TempDB that are internally structured as a table. But when you have a hash match, SQL Server will create a work file for you. Because the data that is stored in TempDB is then not structured as a table. So it's called a work file. That's for those files. So it's physically stored in TempDB, but organized in a way to represent two files for each partition. So now we have our 20,000 buckets, or four partitions, we have 8 files. Then SQL Server, or in the case of a more theoretical academic approximation, the algorithm, will read both inputs and store the rows in the appropriate files. So we start by the build input, grab a row from the build input. There's a value there, London. Oh, let's hash it. Ah, goes into bucket 35. Hash the number 35. Goes into partition 2. This row is now stored in the file that represents the build input for partition 2. And it continues that. So by the time the build input is done, we have 4 files, each of them having all the data for 1/4 of your build input in the appropriate file. And I assume, but this is something that I want to try to investigate one day, I assume that it's also storing the bucket number, because otherwise it would have to do the same computation multiple times. It's easier to store that as a small integer along with your data, because hash functions tend to be CPU intensive. It then does the same for the probe input. So at the end, we have 8 files. 4 files with each 1/4 of the build input, 4 files with each 1/4 of the probe input. And then we say those files were small enough, at least the build files were small enough to fit into memory. So we grab build file number 1, we read it, and we store all the data that is in there in memory in the hash table. Finally, we have data in our hash table. And now we can also read the probe file for partition 1, and then do our algorithm. And then 1/4 of our work is done. We clear the memory, and we go to the build file for partition 2. And we repeat the process. And that's the grace hash join. Questions on this? Yes, Daniel.
Does level 1, level 2, level 3 spills have anything to do with this?
They do have something to do with this, but the question is, do level 1, level 2, level 3 spills have something to do with this? They do have some connection with the various stages of the dynamic destaging process, but I have not been able to map them exactly yet. So for now, just keep to the higher the level, the bigger the booba is that you're in. That's actually all you need to know about the level. So that's how a grace hash join works. Now, there is some optimization possible, and SQL Server uses this. Because you process the build input first, by the time you are ready to start on the probe input, you already have your 4, in my example, build partition files. You already know how big they are. So if you kept track while building, which is a tiny overhead to just increase a counter, you can at this point say, hey, this is interesting. Now that I know the real size of the data, partition 2 and partition 4 are each relatively small. I could fit them in memory combined. At that point, SQL Server makes a mental note, and it will create only 3 files when going through the probe input. One for partition 1, one for partition 2 and 4 combined, and one for partition 3. Then we have 7 files, and it will first load partition 1, probe 1, and then it will load the build file for partition 2, add the build file for partition 4 to create a combined hash table, and then go through the combined probe file. And then partition 3, and it's done. So it's a small optimization to slightly lower the pain you have in a grace hash join. But you have pain, because what SQL Server does is, apart from reading both inputs and hashing everything, which is always the cost of your hash match, every row is stored in a file and read from that file later. It's a lot of additional I/O. and yes, tempdb uses the buffer pool, but you just ran out of memory, so your buffer pool is probably under memory pressure. So there might be physical I/O, and even if not, it's a lot of extra work to store all that, even in the buffer pool, grab it back from the buffer pool. So this significantly reduces your performance. Now, let's make all of you even sadder. I love this part of the presentation. Recursive hash join. So I started out by saying if you do a grace hash join, you have to make sure when you choose to do four partitions that each of those four partitions fits into memory. How do you know that for sure in advance? Answer is you don't. So here's what happens in reality. You start your grace hash join, you start building your files, and at one point you're done. And you look at your collected metadata and you say, oh, beep. This build file for partition 3 is still larger than the amount of memory I have available. I messed up. So at this point, it will use yet another hash function to logically split file build file 3 into 2 or 3 or 4 or 200 or whatever number is needed, new files that hopefully are small enough. Due to the data it collects while building the file, it has seen all the rows. You now have more data available so that it has a better chance of going a correct step. And it does this after processing the build input. So what happens is your build input is processed. It's written into four files. We see that file 3 is too large. File 3 is read again and then written to, for instance, six new files, 3.1 to 3.6. More overhead. And then your probe input is read and it's distributed to the file for partition 1, the combined file for partition 2 and 4, remember that optimization, and the six files for 3.1, 3.2 until 3.6. Now, this is called recursive hash join for a reason. Because it is, in theory, possible that despite all the data we had available when we split 3 into 3.1 to 3.6, 3.5 is still too large. So, yay, 3.5.1, 3.5.2, 3.5.3, and it's recursive. Yay! So that's your recursive hash join. Now the one I skipped. And this is the one that SQL Server typically uses. It's the hybrid hash join, which effectively combines everything we did. So a hybrid hash join, unlike a grace hash join, a full grace hash join starts, like the way I described it, by immediately allocating those files and putting everything there. It's a negative idea of we will probably overflow, so let's just write to those files immediately and take the hit immediately. A hybrid hash join is more optimistic. It starts by saying, let's hope that unicorns actually exist. Let's hope we have enough memory here. So it puts everything in memory until that moment when suddenly, poof, no unicorns anymore. We run out of memory. At that point, it will say, okay, now I need to pretend I started as a grace join, but I already did some work. So it will then partition the buckets, and it will create files for some of the partitions, but not all of them. So my simplistic example, we started with 20,000 buckets, stuffed everything in memory. At one point, we are still getting rows, but our memory is gone. We have a lot of data in memory already, a lot of data still waiting to be processed, but we're out of memory. So at this point, we create partitions 1 to 4. It creates, for instance, for example, three files for partitions 2, 3, and 4. And then it first has to go back to the hash table it already has. And for each bucket, determine, is this partition 1? Then we can keep it in memory. Or is this partition 2, 3, and 4? Then we dump it to the file and free up the memory. And after that, roughly 3/4 of the memory we had is free again, and we can process the rest of the data. If there's no recursion happening, or otherwise you know the process, but assuming there's no recursion happening to keep this at least not too complex, at the end of that, we will have partition 1 already in the hash table, and partitions 2, 3, and 4 in files. Then it starts doing the probe input, and during the probe input, it will do a sort of combination. Where it reads a probe row. Oh, London. Hash it. 35. Hash it. Partition 1. Ah, we have that in memory. We can process it immediately. Next row. Washington. Oh, hash it. 200. Hash it again. Partition 4. Write it to file. Next row. So then you see that it switches between the in-memory processing and the grace processing. And when that initial complex phase is done, then it will continue as the normal grace join for partitions 2 and 3 and 4. Or partitions 2 and 4 combined, and then 3.1, 3.2, 3.3.1, 3.3.2, etc. Is all of this clear? Good. The dynamic destaging, the term I used at first when I hoped I would be immediately done because all of you would already know this. I'm so disappointed. Sorry. Anyway, the dynamic destaging, where the hash match starts as an in-memory hybrid hash join, and if the number of files is too many, it will degrade into a full grace hash join. And it may degrade further into a recursive hash join if needed. This entire process is what Microsoft means when they talk about dynamic destaging, which, by the way, they do not do in a lot of their official documentation. I also talked about dynamic role reversal, and dynamic role reversal only happens for partitions that have been written to disk. So it can happen for all partitions if you have a full grace hash join, and it can happen for the remaining partitions if you do this dynamic, hybrid hash join. Because the first partition is processed in memory, it never hits the disk. It cannot do a dynamic role reversal for that first partition, but it can do it for the rest. If SQL Server compiles an execution plan with a hash match, the optimizer knows that one of the tables has to go in memory, and the other does not. The optimizer uses estimates to guess which of those tables is smaller and which of those two is larger. And here's the thing. If you look at the hash match algorithm, it's not hard to understand that if you can choose, you want the smaller table in memory, not the larger one. So the optimizer will always try to put the smaller table as the first input. This is also the reason why there is a complete, all the operations are mirrored. There's a left anti-semi join and a right anti-semi join. There's a left outer join and a right outer join. This is not the case for all join operators. The nested loops does have a left outer join, but not a right outer join. It cannot always switch the tables around. Hashmatch can always switch them around. So the optimizer will always try to give you the smallest table as the build input. That's the good news. But it's based on estimates. And that's the bad news, because estimates can be wrong. But while we are busy wasting a lot of time stuffing all that data in our files because it doesn't fit in memory anymore, during that period, SQL Server is keeping track of a lot of data. So when the time comes to say, oh, now I'm ready to process partition 2, it will say, how large was the build input for partition 2 in reality? And how large was the probe input for partition 2 in reality? And then if it turns out that the probe input for partition 2 is smaller, it will simply say, yeah, I'm doing a left outer join between 1 and 2, but I'm going to do a right outer join between 2 and 1 now. And then the probe input is suddenly the build input, and the build input is suddenly the probe input. And you may have to write that down and read it 5 times to really understand it. Because I always have to think when I even pronounce these sentences. It's complex, but it's true. And that's dynamic role reversal. So this is a situation where, yes, we are unhappy because, yes, we are spilling. But at least in this specific scenario, SQL Server does a smart trick to make sure it hurts less than it could have hurt. OK, time to mentally prepare for the worst of the worst. Bailout is the worst possible scenario. I talked about this recursive grace hash join. What if at one point we decide it makes no sense to stop recursing? that may be due to an internal limit where the algorithm says, I'm not going to do more than so many levels. But there's also scenarios where sometimes it doesn't help anymore. If you have 20 gigabytes of memory available, and you are hashing by city name, and your customer base is so large that if you only look at the New York customers, it's already 30 gigabytes. Remember, hash function is deterministic. Every New York customer will always go to bucket 35. Whatever you do on the next level of hashing to get to a partition from that bucket, all those level 35s will be combined together. No matter how often you recurse it, bucket 35 will still be a single bucket that has to be complete in a single partition. So if you have a 30 gigabyte partition, a bucket, and you need to fit it in 20 gigabyte of memory, recursion doesn't help anymore. Even a partition of one bucket in the partition will still overflow memory. And that's where bailout happens. So bailout is when SQL Server says, okay, further recursion doesn't help me anymore. I can't use HashMatch. And I still want to give you your results, so I'm going to switch for this partition only, by the way, not for everything, but for this partition only, I'm going to switch to a different algorithm, either nested loops or a merge join. Now, let's go through how much fun we're having right now. We read everything. We stored it in files in TempDB. We figured that one of those files was too big, so we read it back and stored it across multiple files. We recursed it a number of times for one or more of those files until we decided to give up. Then we say, okay, for this file, 3.2.2.3.8, whatever, I'm going to switch to something else. So we have a build file for 3.2.2.3.8 and a probe file for that same number. They're both too large for disk, for memory. They're both in a file, so they're not indexed. It's just data randomly collected. We can do a nested loops, means we take one row from that file that is too large to fit in memory, so it probably has a lot of rows. We're going to find matches in that other file that is not indexed and is also too large to fit into memory, so probably has a lot of rows. And we're going to repeat that for every row in that file that is too large to fit into memory and hence has probably a lot of rows. Are we happy yet? Okay, maybe nested loops is not a good idea. We also have merge join, right? Merge join is much faster, just a single pass across each data. Oh, it has to be sorted. So we have two files that are too large to fit into memory because they have too many rows. And we have to sort them using a sort operator that wants them all in memory, but it doesn't fit in memory. So now the sort operator that you don't see in your execution plan because it's part of this whole degrading experience, this implied sort operator, is spilling to disk. Now a sort operator can complete on data that doesn't fit in disk, so it will complete eventually, hopefully. Except that probably your junior DBA has already restarted the server by now. Because they think it's dead. But it will finish eventually. So yeah, used on the statistics, it gathers while building the files. The algorithm will try to choose the best option between nested loops or merge join, the one that hurts the least. But it's still going to hurt you a lot. So I don't want to leave on this terrible note. So the last thing I want to talk about when talking about spills is good news. Yes, we have good news too. Bit vector filtering. Bit vector filtering is always used when stuff spills and we write stuff in files. So it's always used unless you are in an in-memory join. When SQL Server uses bit vector filtering, it allocates a bitmap with one bit for every possible value of the hash function. So I'm going to stick to my theoretical hash function with 1 to 20,000. That's 20,000 bits. That's 2.5k bytes. That's not going to hurt anyone. So that's really a very small amount of memory set aside with 20,000 bits that are all reset to their starting value. I assume zero. It could be one. I don't know how Microsoft built it. Let's assume zero. When SQL Server is writing data to those disks, it knows for which bucket that data is because it already hashed the value. So it finds a row in your build input that is for bucket 35. It will go to your bitmap and set bit number 35 to 1. And then if it finds the next build row for bucket 200, it will set bit 200 to 1. And if the next row is also for bucket 200, it will change that 1 to a 1, which is no change at all. Now your build phase is done, and your probe phase starts. And during your probe phase, SQL Server normally would say, I'm going to hash something, and find the bucket number, find the partition number, and write it to disk. And I'm going to read it later and do a lot of work. What it actually does is, it reads the row, it finds the bucket number, and says, oh, this is bucket number 35. Let's check the bitmap. 35, bit is set. So there may be a match. It doesn't need to be a match. It can be a hash collision, but there may be a hash. I need this row. I need to check it later. It is going to be written to a file. Next row, we hash it. Result is 82. Bit 82 is not set. That means that during the entire build phase, not a single row was added to bucket 82. So what does that mean for the probe row that hashes to 82? There will be no match. That doesn't mean it's not an interesting row. For a right outer join, we want that as output. For a right anti-semi join, we want that as output, etc. But we can do that immediately. We don't need to stuff it into a file and then read it later because we already know it will never match. So at this point, SQL Server will say, okay, I'm going to process this row now and not write it to disk and then reread it later. That's where, yes, we are in a world of pain, but at least we just have eliminated a very small, let's say, Iceland-sized amount of pain. The rest of the world still hurts. So here is everything on what happens when your hash match spills to disk. You thought it was just a triangle saying, you just wrecked your performance, or rather I did. So everything here is we can go on under the covers when you see that triangle. And if you run the right demo, you can actually observe some of those processes by looking at the output. Like I said, you should never believe what I say. You should always look at the results before you believe me. So I have a very simple example here. And what I do here is I have a simple query where I grab a subset of the build input and a subset of the probe input, and I use variables. So I want the first 500 rows from the build and the first 100 rows from the probe. But I tell the optimizer, ignore reality. Give me a plan that pretends we're going to do 1,000 rows from the build and 100 from the probe. Well, I'm telling SQL Server to estimate higher than reality. This is probably not going to spill. And that's correct. If you look at the execution plan, you see no triangles, there's no spilling. If you scroll through the results, you will see the same results we saw before, all sorted, because there's an inner join, and this is the unicorn world where the order is actually preserved. But what if instead we tell SQL Server, yeah, we're going to do 500 rows, but when computing the memory grant, pretend we're going to do only 100. This is really best practice for production code, right? I'm glad you laugh and don't take this seriously. If people now would have started nodding, I would have been very concerned. And with these glasses, I wouldn't even have seen it. Anyway, if I run this, I expect that there will be insufficient memory, and we start spilling. And we can already see that in the output. People memorize the previous output, they will realize that there's some rows missing here. Well, they're not missing from the output, but you see here that the rows are sorted, but incomplete. And when I scroll down, after 90, you will see that it resets, And now it starts processing the next partition and the third partition. And we see now that it has been processing three partitions. I cannot see whether that means that it automatically started at three partitions or made four partitions and then combined two or stuff like that. But I do see that the final result was three partitions. And for each of those partitions, the order was retained. But for the total result set, it's no longer ordered, which is why the optimizer doesn't consider hash match to be an order retaining operator. Now, this is a quite simple spilling. This is just the first stage. Let's make our lives a bit harder. Let's do 2,000 rows in the build input while estimating for just 100. When this happens, you look at the execution plan, yes, you will see that a lot of misery was going on. It's still spill level 1, by the way, so there is, to answer your question, there's really not that much connection between the spill level and the phases, because I'm going to show you how many phases we can see here. If you look at the results, and for the record, I should have pointed out before, I switched to a full outer join here, because that gives more insight in what's happening. So if you look at the start, you will see that, like you expect with a full outer join, it is sorted by the probe output, with the write retained joins rows in between. And we go through the sorted data a bit. And then at the end, or at the end of the first partition, you get this random order of the left retained rows. We saw this before. But there is one weird thing that you may have noticed. If you look at this first block of data with the left retained rows, there's far more left retained rows than you would expect. Remember, of the 5 letters I used in the 2 inputs, 3 overlapped and 2 didn't. So you expect 40% non-matches and 60% matches. There's more than 40% non-matches here. That's the bit vector filtering. Those are rows that, due to the bit vector filtering, fall into a bucket that was empty. So what was going on here was that SQL Server did the entire build processing with all the spilling, and nothing was output yet. And then it started doing the probe. And the probe is not just doing, oh, partition 1 is in memory, so I can process it, and the rest goes to file. No, it is partition 1 is in memory, so I can process it. The other partitions, there's a bit vector map, and I can sometimes process it if I already know that there's no match. Those are the ones you are seeing here. And the rest goes to disk. Whee! Moving on, because that was only the start of the output. So I'm going to scroll down again, past the left retained rows, until suddenly I start seeing, I need to check where that happens, yeah. Here, we suddenly see matched rows again. And now, the nulls are on the right-hand side. So now we don't get the order we expected, but we get the reverse order. What happened? Well, what happened is that the real sizes for the build input was 2,000 rows, and for the probe input was 1,000 rows. So and I forced the order. In this case, I pushed the estimator into giving me the order it wanted. If the estimator had the freedom of choice, it might have given me a different plan. But I forced the estimator and the optimizer in this case. But during execution, the operator said, hey, the build input is actually larger than the probe input for this partition. Well, in this case, for all partitions. But in more complex scenarios, it may change per partition. But in this case, you will see if you scroll down that for every next partition, the roles have been reversed. And what is in the file for the probe input will be used as the build input. And what was stored in the file as the build input will be used as the probe. And you will see multiple blocks where, here you see it reset, using the normal sorted order. And then sometimes there will be blocks of other rows in between. Not as many, because most of those have been filtered out already by the bit vector filtering. That's why you don't see the large blocks of randomly ordered nulls here anymore. That's a lot to go through. All of this is in this demo, and I hope you like that. Any questions so far? Because this concludes what I have on the spilling. Yes?
When it has to do a bailout, is there an execution time indicator that it has done so?
The question is, If it has to do a bailout, is there an execution plan indicator that it has done so? My answer is I do not know. As far as I know, I have never been able to force a bailout yet. I think I could if I wanted to try, but I would have to set up a complete new demo. The simple way to force it is to make sure that there is more data with the same value, with the same hash key, than fits in the memory. But I would have to set up different sample data than what I have now. I've never done that. There are no specific properties that I know of that always say bailout yes or no. But maybe you can see it in the warning level that it adds additional text if a bailout was done. I don't know. You had a question too, Donald? Mm-hmm.
So then what is then causing the whole thing to build to this? Okay, we have these overflow pointers.
Okay, the question is, since I showed this diagram where the hash table is actually only pointers, which is fairly small, how can we run out of memory? Reason is because those pointers are to rows that are in memory. Either in the buffer pool, if they are just being read from a table and without processing fed into the build phase, or somewhere in working memory if they are produced by another operator, but they are in memory. And SQL Server has mechanisms to say this row needs to stay in memory. Because if a row in the buffer pool is pointed to from a hash table, then regular buffer pool cleaning should never evict that row. And there's mechanisms in place to ensure that it stays in memory. So all those rows that are pointed to by the hash table fill your available memory. They're all part of your memory grant, and when you run out, you get a slap on the wrist by SQL Server when you try to use more memory. Is that a sufficient answer, Erland? Yeah, the simple case of a row in the buffer pool, that row is marked as being used by your query. When SQL Server goes through the buffer pool to clean up space, that row is untouched. And at one point, you have too many of those rows that are fixed in the buffer pool, and then SQL Server has to do something else. That's when spilling happens. Any other questions? Cool. Now, you surely all want to know how a memory grant is computed. Now that we suddenly realize how important it is that the memory grant is correct, do we want to know how it is computed? No? Oh, yes, OK. Now, I have bad news for you. I've never been able to completely reverse engineer this formula. But I do have some interesting research in that area, and I'm going to share some of that research with you. So there are multiple influences to the memory grant. Obviously, the estimated number of rows in the build and the estimated row size of the build are a major contributing factor. And if you have character data in your build input, then regardless of whether you define it as varchar or char, the cardinality estimator will always assume for the memory grant that they are filled to half the maximum length. So a varchar 500 will be estimated to be, on average, 250 bytes. A char 500 will also be estimated to occupy, on average, 250 bytes, because SQL Server internally does not store that with padding. SQL Server removes the padding in internal storage and adds it again in the output, which makes sense. But to my surprise, the size and the amount of rows in the probe actually influenced the memory grant. What did not influence it was the actual keys used. So if you have five columns and one of them is the joint key, or all five of them are the joint key, that does not affect the size of the hash table. And except for aggregation and flow distinct, logical operation does also not affect the size of your hash table. So here's the code I used to try to reverse engineer how SQL Server computes a memory grant. And this is as you can see in the sidebar, it's a huge amount of code. And I'm not going to run it all, I'm not going to show it all, but I'm going to show how I did it. So I used the same basic structure of query I've been using throughout this entire session, where I influence the size by using an optimize for. I don't need to run any of these queries. Well, actually I do, because I don't know why. The memory grant is part of the estimated plan, because SQL Server needs to know how much memory to allocate before it starts executing. But if you request an estimated plan, you do not see the memory grant. So that's why the actual sizes are always 100. I want the actual query to run fast. But here is what I feed the optimizer to determine how much memory grant to allocate. So my first experiment, I say, what if I join a hash key of key 1 and key 2, an integer and a char 1? What if in the second query it's just the integer? What if in the third query it's a char 1 and an integer and a char 1000? I always do a select star, never do select star in production, so that the amount of data stored is the same. We always need that filler in our output, but in this case we're also joining on it, in this case we are not. If I look at these three queries, and it helps to actually enable execution plans, then you can see that the first query has a memory grant of almost 60,000 K. The second has the same number, and the third also has the same number. So it doesn't matter which of the columns in the hash tables are the input for the hashing function, the size of the hash table will always be the same. So then I used a similar block of code to check whether an inner join or a full join, and I could have added more, and I actually added more. This is what you see here is only a subset of what I actually ran that gives you an idea of the things I tested and how I tested them, and those also had the same memory grant. Now the build input obviously does affect the memory grant. So if I say I want to return only an integer and a char 1 column, so that I don't need to store that char 1000 filler anymore, and I expect 10,000 rows, or I want only the integer for the same 10,000 rows, or I want everything, including the char 1000 for those 10,000 rows, well then, quite obviously, you do get different memory grants. The first one has a memory grant of 5,648, the second of 5,528, so we shaved a little off by not including the char 1 column, and when we add back the char 1000, you need a bit more memory. The most interesting part came after that, when I started varying the estimated row count of the build, 100, 10,000, 100,000, or started changing the probe size. So here we have a 10,000 build, 10,000 build, 100 probe, 10,000 probe, and more examples. And it turned out that all of those had effect. And I did all kinds of tests, way more than we have here. And the results of those tests are still not enough to come to a full conclusion. But I did make some interesting graphs where in my first query, I had a probe size of just one row, estimated. And a build size of going from zero rows up to 2.5 million, if I read the number of zeros correctly. And I entered the grant every time, and I plotted that, and I tried to come up with a formula which is as an Excel formula here, and typed in clear text here, which approximates, but is not exactly the same as the numbers I actually see. But what you see is a pattern where the memory grant scales linearly with the build size until it hits a threshold, and then boom, it drops down again. And then it scales at a slightly lower angle, then it drops down again, and then on the most right-hand side graph, you see that there is not a third point where it drops again, at least not in the range that I experimented with. I did a similar one adding the char 1000, and then you see that the angles and the numbers change, but the overall shape of the graph remains the same. Then I did my query that surprised me, because now I kept the build size the same, very small, but I had continuously increasing probe size. And now you see that if the probe size increases, your memory grant also increases, not linearly, but logarithmically. And again, I used it with different sizes of data. And now you see when I added the char 1000 and came to bigger values, I managed to hit that same point where you suddenly saw a drop. Then I did the same with where I did the same with a larger build. So now my build is larger, and I'm again varying the probe size for the same build size. And you see on the right-hand side that same logarithmic value, but you also see a plateau that's more clearly visible on the left-hand side, where it doesn't change for a while. And with different values, you get the same graph. So I cannot give you the complete formula. I have not been able to determine that. That would probably require months of just keeping changing the numbers and trying stuff. But what I have found is the build input has a linear effect on the memory grant, not unexpected. If the probe size is larger than the build plus a certain threshold, then it starts adding a logarithmical decreasing extra. If the probe input is smaller than the build minus a threshold, then there's a reduction, but that's linear. So that's the graph you saw that went up like straight line, plateau, that's the threshold, and then a logarithmic part. In between those two, so after adding the logarithmical decreasing extra bit before the linear reduction, the base formula for the build based on the build input is lowered once you hit the 2 megabyte and the 6 megabytes thresholds. Why? Because that's what Microsoft apparently did based on the data I see. And then there's the final rules that are applied. It's always a multiple of 8 kilobytes. It's never less than slightly over a megabyte. And of course, there's a maximum based on your hardware. Your memory grant will never be more than what your hardware supports, because there's no sense in asking for more. How are we doing for time? 12 o'clock. So I have 50 minutes left, so I can get through this, and I will have to spare you the hash teams. So far, it was all very simple, right? Everything I've done so far was extremely simple, because I've always been talking about plans with only a single hash match operator. Here's an execution plan that has a few more, 4 of them in total. And for easier reference, I've numbered them. Now, when SQL Server tries to allocate the memory grant, how does this work? Each of those 4 has its own memory requirement. But are they running at the same time? Well, we know how the hash match works, right? I went over that in the first 75 minutes. So we know when this execution plan starts running, the select operator will ask a row from compute scaler, will ask a row from hashmatch 1, who will ask a row from hashmatch 2, etc. And the first row actually returned will be by the clustered index seek on the top left, returns through the top to the hashmatch, which stores it in a build table, in the hash table, and it asks the next row. So at first, operator 3 and its build input will be active and the rest will all be waiting, because we have this blocking phase where the hash table is built. So this is the first logical phase of the query where operator 3 is building its hash table and not outputting any rows. Question, Daniel.
That's the reason that 3 and 4 would be building their inputs at the same time.
You said that 3 and 4 will be building their inputs at the same time, but that's incorrect because number 2 hasn't asked a row from its probe input yet. And it will not ask a row from its probe input until the build input is done. That's why you should always read execution plans from left to right, in addition to reading them from right to left in every other order. Because you need to understand that data flow is important, but the flow of execution is also important. Anyway, this first phase is only hashmatch 3 and its build input active. And it's using memory to stuff data in a hash table. Once that build input is done, it starts the probe input, but the probe input is flowing. So now it grabs data from its probe input, but as soon as it finds a match, returns that to hashmatch number 2, which says, thank you very much, I'm going to store this in memory, and then give me the next row, please. So now we see that hash match number 3 is in its probe phase, while hash match number 2 is in its build phase. Hash match number 3 still needs the memory, because as long as this probe phase is running, every row may be needed there. We don't know in advance which rows will not be needed until we're done. So we need to keep them all in memory. But hash match number 2 starts to build memory as well, because it starts building this table. Then hash match number 3 is done. And now hash match number 2 says, OK, now I need to start my probe input. And now hash match number 4 starts to build. So hash match number 2 asks for a row, but doesn't get anything in return, because hash match number 4 now starts to block. Now hash match number 4 is building, but at this phase, hash match number 3 is already done. The probe phase for hash match number 2 is completed. All the data has been processed or written to files in the case of a spill, but it will never be called again. So the memory allocated to hash match 3 is now no longer needed. It can be freed up, and hash match number 4 can reuse the same memory. So the memory grant for this query will not be the total of all 4 hash match operators combined, because SQL Server knows that numbers 3 and 4 will never run at the same time. Let's continue through this. 2 has all the data in memory, is waiting for data while 4 is building, and also needs memory. Then 4 starts using its probe phase. It collects rows. Those flow through 4, through 2, who is also in its probe phase, to hash match aggregate number 1, who now joyfully starts building its hash table. So now we have a memory requirement for the entire hash table of number 2, the entire hash table of number 4, and the entire hash table of number 1. And then when the probe input there is done, hash match number 1, and this is the final phase in this case, will start outputting data, still needing its hash table in memory until this is done. So if the actual execution plan is bigger, you make it more phases. And all of this is known to the optimizer. And it's also important to point out that these are inner joins and aggregations. There are some subtle differences based on the logical operations used. For instance, a flow distinct is very different from a hash match aggregate. But in this case, these are all the phases. SQL Server does, unfortunately, not give us any insight in a per-operator contribution to memory grant. I personally would love, if I have a problem query, to be able to click on operator 3 and see, for this operator, I wanted so much memory grant. Because if the total memory grant of this query is too small or too big or whatever, I want to know which of the operators is probably the root cause. They may all be somewhat misestimated. It's also possible that one of them is severely misestimated. I want to be able to find it, and that's hard. Because SQL Server does not tell me, oh, for hash match number 3, I thought I needed 10 gigabytes. And for hash match number 2, it was 5 gigabytes. So for the second phase, when they were together, it's 15. It only gives me the grand total. But this gives me some insight. And that's the memory fractions in and the memory fractions out. Those are properties that you can see in an execution plan, and they will tell you the fraction available during the build phase and during the probe and the final phase. So what SQL Server does is first it estimates the size for every hash match operator, and sort operators, by the way. I'm not touching on them, but they are taken into account here as well. Then it identifies for every phase which operators need the memory concurrently. It tries to find the phase that has the hardest memory requirement. That's your memory grant. Then it goes back through all the phases and tells each operator, OK, during this phase, you can use this amount of memory. During that phase, you can use that amount of memory. And that's what we can see in the execution plan. So here is the exact query. A very realistic production query that we always are running that produced the execution plan I showed you before. It's the exact same execution plan, except that the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4 are not there. And if I look at this hash match and I go to the properties, well, it was already open. I always leave the properties window open because I'm looking at them all the time. Then you will see I'm going to zoom in here, that there's a property called memory fractions and a plus sign you can click and to expand. And then I need to move the bar a bit. So now you can see that there's a memory fractions input of one, saying this operator during its build phase, you can use all the memory that I have available because you're the only guy running at this time. But during your probe phase, you can only use 5.6% of the memory because someone else is using the rest. Who is that someone else? Well, remember during the probe phase of that hash match, this guy was building. And if we look here, for this operator at the memory fractions input, you will see that this is the remainder after the removing those 5.6%. And you can go through all the operators and through all the phases, and you will see that for every phase, the active operators, if you look at the appropriate memory fractions input or output, they all add up to 100, except for one case where they add up to slightly less, because there's two phases and one of them has two operators active, and the third has the same two operators plus a third one active. And that's the one that adds up to 100, and the one that has only the two, yeah, it's the same numbers, but one of the numbers has been gone. And that's how you can gain some insight in how SQL Server distributes this memory among operators in a real plan. Unfortunately, there's not a simple way to look at these numbers and the total memory grant and then say, oh, now I know that for this operator it was 50 megabytes. So that's something that, I don't know if there's anyone from Microsoft here, but that's something I would really like to see exposed in execution plans on a hash match or a sort. The memory grant contribution for this operator was so much. And clicking doesn't really help if you are not in your presentation. So like I said, hash teams is something you will have to learn from the slides because I'm starting to run out of time. In fact, I have only 3 minutes left. So what I'm going to give a quick explanation and skip the demo. What hash teams does is hash teams looks for multiple hash operators that have the same hash key. So if you have two hash matches and one hashes on city and other hashes on country, you do not get a hash team. But if you have two hash operators and they both hash on city, then it will be added together into a single hash team, and there will be a team manager, and the team manager supervises everything. It determines the hash function used, it oversees the memory distribution, and it ensures that if those operators spill, they spill combined and in a more in a less inefficient way than they would have if they had been not in a hash team. And I have a demo where you can see that in the case of a large spill, there is a small performance difference. When I have two versions of the same query, one I have weird column keys in every join, and the other one I have the same weird column keys in every join. And then the same has slightly faster performance when it spills. And that's it. I still have, I think, 1 minute for questions, but I will happily take questions after. If you have questions later, mail me or tweet me. I will try to answer questions as to the best of my knowledge. Again, please let me know what you liked. Let me know what I could have done better. And then maybe I will return next year and it will be a whole day session. Who knows? Thank you for your attention. Enjoy your lunch. Enjoy the rest of the day.